Reformed Church.
It's interesting, you know, that if you were to ask Christians, or maybe almost ask anyone, you know, what are the commandments of God, right? Probably the most popular answer that you would get is that people would start reciting the Ten Commandments, right? And even though, you know, it is so clear in Scripture, right, that the Ten Commandments were under a priesthood, they were under the Levites, right? That the sacrifices were sacrifices of animal sacrifices. But it's interesting that even though today we have new promises, today we have a new high priest, today we have a new sacrifice, people still today, instead of quoting the law of under the New Testament, they still quote the Old Testament laws. I'll read this to you in Hebrews chapter 7 and in verse number 12. He says, "For the priesthood being changed of necessity, there is also a change of law," right? Jesus, obviously, who was not a Levite, right? He wasn't a Levite. He was born under the tribe of Judah. It's just an interesting thing to see how people miss the fact that Hebrews 7, again, it's so clear. Because the priesthood had changed, because now it is no longer the Levitical priesthood, because our high priest today is Jesus Christ, right? We miss the fact that there's been a change of law.
Right. We sort of keep certain things from the Old Testament, and we sort of say that other things have converted to the new, and it's just obviously it's crazy. And that's a pretty common thing. If you'd ask somebody what are one of God's commandments, they're gonna pretty much name you one of the Ten Commandments.
Ten Commandments, right away, yeah.
And also a great verse to show you, because Pastor Zay was just talking about that there's been a change of law, and people just do not realize that. Well, okay, so the Ten Commandments and the Old Testament law was put in place in Exodus 20. Okay, so that's a truth. And Hebrews 7 is saying there's been a change of law now in this New Testament. I mean, which shouldn't surprise us, like you just said. There's been a change of everything else. Our priests, our sacrifices, you know, the tabernacle, all those things have been changed. Why wouldn't we have a change of law also if it's a new testament, if it's a new covenant? And Romans 3:27 basically just lays out the transition between these two different laws. It calls the Old Testament law the law of works by saying, it says, "Where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? No, but by the law of faith." Right there, it lays out the two different laws, how one transitioned to the other. Again, we already read in Hebrews 7 that it says there's been a change of law. But what law were we changing from? Well, it names the first law and says, by what law? Of works. So there is a law of works. And the law of works, the Ten Commandments and all the things given from Mount Sinai. That's the Old Testament law. And obviously, it's fitting that it's called the law of works, because the Old Testament law commands a bunch of works. Thou shalt not, you shall do this, you shouldn't do this. They're all works. They're all actions for us to do. The Old Testament law doesn't command us to put faith in Jesus. The Old Testament law, that's you won't find that in the Old Testament law. The Old Testament law, as far as the law given from Mount Sinai, is all works. And here it says that there is a law of works. But it's referring to actually Abraham here, I believe. And it says that he was keeping, essentially, the law of faith. It says his boasting was excluded. By what law? Of works? No, but by the law of faith. So he names two laws here, law of works and law of faith. And there are two different laws. The law of works is actually the Old Testament law, and the law of faith is actually the name for the New Testament law. In this New Testament, the law is to put faith in Jesus. And that may sound a little bit weird, but you know, we'll get more into that.
Yeah, so just like you said then, so if we know that under the Ten Commandments, under the law of Moses, obedience was our works, right? So if, like you said, Romans 3:27 says, by what law? The law of works? No, but by the law of faith. So if the New Testament law is the law of faith, like you mentioned, faith in Jesus, right? So then what would our obedience be, right? Right? If we live under the law of faith, then what would our obedience be? And in verse Romans 16:26, and this is coming out of the ASV, it says, "According to the commandment of the eternal God is made unto all, unto you, unto all the nations, unto obedience of faith." Our obedience to that commandment, right, that we have in the new covenant is obedience of faith. Same exact thing written in Romans 1:5. We received grace and apostleship unto what? Unto obedience of faith. So it's so clear that it says obedience of faith, that we know that our obedience today to God is not if we don't covet, which obviously God is not approving of covetous. He's not approving of any wrong, of any sin. But the point is, it's not that God considers it considers that which is wrong right now. It's that that's not the point. The point is, what is our obedience, right? And our obedience to God is the obedience of faith, right?
And again, it just makes sense because of the fact that if again, I've said this before, but if you just humor us for a second even with that, but we just read the verse in Romans 3 where it says that there's a law of faith and there's a law of works.
Yep.
Furthermore, we know in this new covenant there has been a change of law because Hebrews 7 just said so.
Right.
And what we're saying is that we have transitioned from the law of works to what is in this New Testament called the law of faith. God has a different law right now. But the verses you just read about the obedience of faith, if we were living under a law of faith, what would your obedience be? It would be obedience of faith. So, of course, it just makes sense. People just don't pick up on this. The fact that he mentions the law of faith in Romans 3, and then throughout Romans, he starts talking about the obedience of faith, which if you were living under a law of faith, that would be your obedience, would be faith in Jesus. And that is God's, actually, his current law. And it's called the obedience of faith. Furthermore, John 6:29, Jesus answered and said unto them, when a group of people came to him, they were asking how to work the works of God. And Jesus said, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent.
Yep.
Jesus came to establish a new covenant. And when he came, there were people that came up to him and said, hey, how do we do the works of God? We want to do works for God. And Jesus says, this is the work, that you believe on him whom he sent. In other words, that you believe on himself. Jesus was saying that believing in him is the work that God wants you to do. But again, this all just fits together with the fact that there has been a change of law. And if it really is the law of faith, which it is, it makes sense that Jesus would tell them that's how you keep the works of God in this new covenant, is to believe in himself. Romans 6:17 also talks about that we have obeyed from our heart the form of doctrine that we were delivered.
Yep.
Again, obedience in this new covenant is in our mind. All of the obedience that we, you know, obey God with in this new covenant is from our mind. In the Old Testament, it was a law of works. So you would obey that law with works, like Pastor Zay was just saying, by like not coveting or something. In this New Testament, though, if God has commanded faith, and if Jesus tells us, this is the work I want you to do in this New Testament, is to believe in me, which was never commanded in the Old Testament, then it makes sense that Paul would call that obedience from our heart, because that's how we obey God in the New Testament. Old Testament, you obeyed by works. New Testament, you obey from your mind or from your heart.
Yeah, actually, I love that verse in Romans 6:17, obeyed from the heart, that form of doctrine. So it tells you your obedience, and then it tells you that form of doctrine, speaking about Jesus Christ and him crucified.
You right, know, and heart so is just good. Another word for our minds.
Sure.
Obviously, we should know that. I mean, that's why even Paul talks about in Romans itself, it says that we believe with our heart and confess with our mouth. So heart is actually the place where you believe. Jesus
mind.
Even talked about to the religious leaders, saying that he knew the thoughts of their heart. So your heart is just another word for your mind, and that's why when it says you obey from your heart, saying, you just obey from your mind with your thoughts.
Yeah, so it's, and so then people would say, okay, well, if you're saying then that my obedience is just my faith, then does that mean then that I can go on coveting and that, you know, so what happens? What happens with good works? What happens with things that are right to do, right? What happens to honoring your father and your mother, right? And the truth of the matter is that these are things that they also obviously don't happen automatically, right? I don't get saved and then all of a sudden now all of my works are automatically good. But the cool thing is that as we continue to renew our mind, right, as we continue to, like you were saying, as we continue to obey from the heart that form of doctrine, learning what Jesus has done, learning what he provided for us, right, our mind then is continually renewed. And it's through that renewal of our mind then, that by the Spirit of God then, right, the works of the flesh then are put to death, right, and he is able then to work in and through us to work out all these good things, to work the not covetousness, to work, you know, the honoring of your father and your mother. Romans 12:2, right, says, and do not be conformed to this world, right? We don't want to be like this world, like the Gentiles of this world, not to be conformed to their behavior, right, but to be transformed by what? By the renewing of our mind, by the obedience of our heart, by the renewing of our mind to what Jesus has done, right? We don't renew our mind to anything else. The renewal of our mind is accomplished through our obedience.
Right. Obedience is not the good works. Obedience is the faith.
Right.
In this new now, I'm not talking about the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, your obedience would be works. I mean, everybody failed at that, though.
Right.
Obviously, we know the Old Testament was only given to lead us to Christ and to show that you couldn't keep it. Nobody has ever kept the Old Testament law. Stephen even said before he was stoned, he said, you've received the law by the dispensation of angels, he said, or the agency of angels, and you have not kept it. Couldn't keep the old law, that, but the obedience under the old law is works. Obedience in the New Testament is faith. That's the way that it works. But
faith.
So, but it does produce good works,
yep,
by itself, though. Whereas in the Old Testament, the works themselves were the obedience. And again, I mean, how would you think that somebody would react? If you said, you know, whatever, I feel like God's called me to ministry, and I'm just going to obey him and start a ministry. Most people wouldn't even flinch at that.
No.
But the thing is, because we apply the word obedience to something that we do. But in this New Testament, all of our works are supposed to be done by the Holy Spirit as we do one thing, which is just believe. Yep. And that's what 2 Corinthians 3:18, I won't read the whole verse, but it just says that as we behold the glory of Jesus, we're transformed by the Spirit. So there should be no worry or concern by us saying and showing you from Scripture that in this New Testament, the only work that God wants you to do is to believe in his Son and learn him and grow in your knowledge of him. There should be no concern with that. Because if you say, well, what about good works? Well, as you just said from Romans 12 and also in 2 Corinthians 3 here, it says when you behold Jesus, when you believe Jesus, when you learn Jesus, you are transformed. Your actions are transformed by the Spirit. But the actions are transformed by the Spirit, not by us. Our works are not our obedience. Our works are transformed by the Spirit as we behold the Lord and as we learn and believe in Jesus. Our obedience in this new covenant is strictly and solely faith in Jesus. Yeah, that's
our,
it.
Our works are become the results of our faith, the results of our obedience.
Right, the result of our obedience, not the obedience itself. Yeah, awesome. So just remember, this was just a short sort of sample on the topic. We have so much more to say about this. You can go to reforminus.com/reformu. That's our Reform You page. If you're watching this online, you can also just click the link below. And whether it's on YouTube or on our website, there will be a link below where you can click to see more material on this topic. We've got articles, we've got videos and messages and things like that. A lot of stuff that can you can go much more in-depth on this, and especially our Obedience is Faith article is the best thing for you to read on this topic. It will bring you from start to finish and explain the whole thing because there's a lot more than what we said today. But yeah, reforminus.com/reformu.
We hope you enjoyed this message from Reformed Church. If you have, please share this with someone else and help us get this unpopular message to the world. If you'd like to support Reformed Church, you can do so at reforminus.com/give. Also on our website, you can take advantage of our free messages, articles, and even full discipleship courses. Start reforming your mind now at reforminus.com.